From 1961 through 1969, one artist placed 9 hit records within the Billboard Top 40 chart under an unheard of 3 different names: a singer, songwriter, producer, performer, author, and poet. His name was Len Barry, and this is his story.
All right. We've read it hundreds of times. We've said it so many ways. Recited it first in our nursery rhymes and all of the great Shakespeare's plays. Sometimes it comes in a song DJs on the radio play. Eventually we all sing right along, 'cause it says what we want to say. Alright, it's plain and simple. I love you and you love me. Lovers call it poetry. It's fundamental, with or without melody. Lovers call it poetry.
June 12, 1942, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Leonard Warren Borisov is born to parents Joseph and Bernice Borisov in Albert Einstein Medical Center. Young Leonard is raised in mostly black neighborhoods, first in North Philadelphia and later in West Philadelphia. He attends all-white Lamberton Elementary and Bieber Junior High Schools, where he does well, before entering the legendary and almost exclusively black Overbrook High School. Len's dad, Joseph, owns and operates a tap room called the Shamrock, and soon he unofficially changes his last name to Barry to make it easier for his customers to pronounce, and thus his son's future stage name of Len Barry is born. Throughout high school, young Len Barry is interested in sports, where he plays basketball alongside future NBA superstar Wally Jones, with whom he becomes lifelong friends.
When I went to Brook, I started playing basketball with the varsity, who was the best team in the country at that time. I wasn't the best, they were.
Philadelphia heavyweight boxing champion Joe Frazier's manager, Yancey Durham, would later say of Barry, "If he hadn't become a recording star, I think he might have been a successful prize fighter. He was quick, 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 so fast." Also throughout high school, Barry becomes interested in singing. And growing up as he did in mostly black neighborhoods, Barry becomes passionate about black music, R&B and soul, the music of James Brown, Ray Charles, and the Impressions, then called race music. Coincidentally, because it was never intentional, his powerful singing voice, with its sandpaper edge, sounded as though the vocalist was black.
I didn't go to the studio and imitate nobody. I just opened my mouth and that's what came out, because that was my environment.
And Barry forms 2 street corner style singing groups. First, the Brooktones in 1959, followed by the Barrymores a year later in 1960. In 1961, Len Barry graduates from Overbrook High School, and he is soon invited by Philadelphia bass singer Jim Mealy to join his newly formed singing group, the Dovells, as their lead singer. And although it was customary for the lead singer to be billed in front of the backup singing group name, as was the case with Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers, James Brown and the Flames, Little Anthony and the Imperials, Dion and the Belmonts, and more, Barry does not insist, and the name remains just the Dovells. By this time, Barry has also joined the Coast Guard, serving 6 months active duty and 7 years in the Coast Guard Reserve. It is while he is on active Coast Guard duty, he hears a recording he had done with the Dovells called the Bristol Stump, played both on the radio and on Dick Clark's wildly popular national television show, American Bandstand. It turns out the Dovells have a huge hit record. Almost as soon as the newly formed Dovells sign with Philadelphia's Cameo Parkway Records, they have a gigantic hit record called the Bristol Stump.
The kids in Bristol are sharp and whimsical when they do the Bristol Stump. Really something when the joint is jumping when they do the Bristol Stump.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Well, I'm spinning here on Friday night. It's at the greatest in the surprise. But it's late at the crazy sight.
The kids in Bristol are sharp and whimsical when they do the Bristol Stump.
Bristol Stomp is not only a monster hit, it introduces the world to the very unique voice of Dovell's lead singer, Len Barry. The Dovell's next top 40 hit is called Do the New Continental. This is followed by another Bristol-titled hit, this one called Bristol Twistin' Annie. Then came another hit, Hully Gully Baby.
I went down to Miami. I met a girl named Miss Sammy. The moon was bright, the time was right. I said, hey girl, I love ya.
Oh, what you wanna?
And then another smash, this time a reworking of the Phil Upchurch instrumental classic, You Can't Sit Down, with new lyrics by Barry.
Hey pretty baby,
you can't sit down.
Don't you hear the drummer thumping?
You can't sit down.
You gotta shake it like a crazy.
You can't sit down.
Cause the band is saying something.
You can't sit down.
Everybody is jumping.
You can't sit down.
You gotta slap out.
But for the Dovells, there is trouble in paradise. Founder Jim Mealy, suffering from problems with alcohol, has already left the group. And while Barry sees the Dovells as a rock and R&B style soul group, other members see the group as more of a Martin and Lewis Vegas style musical comedy act. So Barry abruptly leaves the group, leaving the name Dovells to the remaining members of the group, and he sets out on his own.
Everyone in the industry knew who I was, that I was Lenny, lead singer of Dovell. Public did not know that. So when I left them the name, the hits that I had. I left everything with the group, and I left unknown by my own self, which was a little bit scary when it should have been very scary.
At the same time Barry leaves the Dovells behind, Philadelphia songwriters John Madeira and Dave White have become red hot. First, as the writer-producers of Danny and the Juniors at the Hop and Rock and Roll is Here to Stay, where White is actually a member of the Juniors, and then as the writers of Leslie Gore's feminist anthem classic, You Don't Own Me. Barry immediately signs with the Madeira White team, who quickly sign him to Powerhouse Decca Records, and together they write and produce a string of big hit records for now solo Len Barry. About the same time as Shirley Ellis's novelty classic The Name Game is topping the charts, the first Len Barry solo record is also a novelty record, called Lip Sync, a fun romp through the Peter Piper Picked a Peck of Pickled Peppers style tongue twister. Although Lip Sync is a Billboard chart record, it is not a big hit. But DJs and radio music directors around the country have taken notice, not only of the totally unique sound of lead singer Len Barry's voice, but also the big orchestral production, suddenly unique in a world of three guitar bands, yet filled with horns and backup singers, led by two other Philadelphia hit singing groups replacing the Dovells, The Times, and the all-girls singing group The Swans. The follow-up to Lip Sync is a record titled 1, 2, 3, and this time, Radio Reacts. 1-2-3 becomes an overnight sensation, topping the Cashbox hit record chart and becoming a number one million-selling international classic. And thrilled with the success of the record, Len Barry thanks everyone involved.
Hi, this is Len Barry, and I'd just like to say that getting a hit record is not as easy as 1-2-3. You do, however, have to have three basic things, and for these, I would like to say some thank yous. First of all, I would like to thank the disc jockeys who did like the record and played it so very, very much. Second of all, I would like to thank my arranger, Mr. Jimmy Wisner, and my producers and songwriters, John Madera and Dave White. But last, and certainly not least, I would like to say a very, very, very much meant thank you to you, the public, who accepted my record so wonderfully.
There are very limited national television appearance opportunities during this era, but Barry does them all. American Bandstand, Hullabaloo, and Shindig. Tours with Dick Clark's Caravan of Stars, Gene Pitney's Shower of Stars, and he often tours with top R&B artists like James Brown and Sam Cooke. His R&B style and lead vocal sound lead Barry to performances at most of the black theaters in America, including the legendary Apollo in New York, the Howard in Washington, D.C., the Regal in Chicago, the Fox in Detroit, and the famous Uptown Theater in Philadelphia. He performs at Philadelphia's legendary all-black Cadillac Club and as the only white act at Atlantic City's Club Harlem with the headlining legendary Sam Cooke on three different occasions. 1-2-3 was a monster hit in Great Britain and all over Europe, and Barry becomes a major singing star in the United Kingdom.
Had an unbelievable career overseas, a great deal more success overseas. I'm grateful for my success in America, but I was had much more success overseas.
He tours there often, including with the Motown Review.
I was a special added attraction on the Motown Review, and we broke all records. I mean, we were supposed to be there like 8 weeks. At 11 weeks, we renewed the whole contract. We included Scotland and Ireland, and we went to Australia, we went to Brisbane.
He makes appearances at London's legendary Royal Albert Hall, and he tours England, Ireland, Scotland, and Wales, appearing on the highly rated Top of the Pops British TV show. Even the Beatles react to Len Barry. John Lennon famously has 1, 2, 3 on his own jukebox. And when George Harrison visits America for the first time and says he'd like to go to the Hollywood Bowl, he is asked who he would like to see there. And he replies, Len Barry. 1, 2, 3 is followed up again by a similarly sounding record titled Like a Baby.
When you
This is also a big hit. Following Like a Baby, Barry takes a surprising and unusual turn. For his third record, he and the Madeira White team decide to record a cover of a Broadway show tune called Somewhere from West Side Story, composed by Leonard Bernstein, along with lyrics by Stephen Sondheim. Although Diana Ross and Broadway star Barbara Streisand both have versions of Somewhere out at the same time, Barry prevails. With the Ross and Streisand records both stalling outside the top 50, Barry's version becomes a major hit. When Somewhere becomes Barry's last solo hit record, some observers question why this white Motown-style artist would cover a Broadway show tune in the first place. But Barry famously says, "It wasn't the fact I recorded a Broadway show tune that broke up my string of hits. It was three guitar bands and the British invasion. I'm from Philadelphia. Philadelphia's a soul town. We don't do guitar bands here." Throughout his career, Barry is called the King of Blue-Eyed Soul, a term he greatly disdains. Blue-Eyed Soul singers are white guys trying to sound black, he would often say. I'm not trying to sound like anything. This is just how I sound. With his string of solo hits broken, Decca Records drops Barry, and he again ventures out on his own, this time as a songwriter and record producer. Inspired by the Dustin Hoffman movie Little Big Man, Barry teams up with future Sal Soul creator Vince Montana Jr., and together they write a funky little instrumental novelty record called Kemosabe. At the same time, there is a John Madeira-backed Philadelphia band called Gulliver, made up of songwriter-guitarist Tim Moore, keyboardist and future Hall of Fame member Daryl Hall, bass player and talented arranger Tom Sellers, and drummer Jim Helmer. Barry recruits Sellers to do the arrangement on Kemosabe, Daryl Hall to play keyboards, and Tim Moore to play guitar. He rounds out the studio players with musicians he knows from his days at the Cadillac Club, and they include such future MFSB members, guitar master Bobby Eli, Norman Harris, Roland Chambers, drummer Earl Young, with a vibraphone solo by Vince Montana Jr. In coordination with John Madeira's Linwood Productions, Barry produces Kemosabe with his band of studio musicians, and he names his fictional group the Electric Indian. Every major record company in America turns down Kemosabe, but Barry persists, putting the record out on his own label called Marmaduke Records, created just for the purpose. It is immediately picked up by Philadelphia's soul station WDAS, and it becomes a regional hit, selling a reported 16,000 records in only 10 days. Based on the regional success of the Marmaduke release, Kemosabe is soon picked up for national release by United Artists, one of the labels who had originally turned it down, and it reaches the top 20 on the Billboard Hot 100 Singles chart, number 6 on Billboard's Easy Listening Survey, and it crosses over to the national R&B chart. First as the lead sound of the Dovells, then as solo star Len Barry, and now under the fictional name The Electric Indian, Barry has charted an astonishing 9 records inside the Billboard Top 30 under an unheard of 3 different names. Barry is now a successful songwriter and record producer, and the legendary John Madeira, who along with writing partner Dave White has written Danny and the Juniors at the Hop and Rock and Roll Is Here to Stay, along with Leslie Gore's classic feminist anthem You Don't Own Me, says of Barry, "Of all the hundreds of songwriters I have worked with and known, Len Barry is the absolute best. I mean, who can write lyrics like that? Absolutely no one." Never a big fan of touring with the long hours of travel, cheap motel rooms, and lousy fast food, Barry came off the road in the late 1960s, and, encouraged by the success of Kemosabe, Barry began to concentrate on songwriting and record production. Even before Kemosabe, Barry and production partner John Madeira had produced the first 2 disco records with Atlanta singing sensation Grover Mitchell. Both were covers of classic songs, and with both of these records, the coming disco groove is on full display. The first of these records is another Broadway show tune, Who Can I Turn To?, from the roar of the grease paint and the smell of the crowd. The second is a cover of Johnny Ray's classic Cry. Both records are released by United Artists, but neither is a hit. However, the next record in the series is a hit. It's his famous instrumental novelty record, Kemosabe, by the fictional Electric Indian. Throughout the 1970s and into the 1980s, Barry has continued success with a string of Barry-written and/or produced hits, many of which were released by Philadelphia's WMOT Productions and Records. Barry and longtime songwriting partner Bobby Eli write Summer Snow for Blue Magic. They also write Give a Broken Heart a Break for Impact, the new Damon Harris group assembled following his departure from the Temptations. Barry produces and co-writes a disco instrumental called Space Bass. The record is not released in America, but it's a huge hit in Europe. The Barry Eli team write another tune which is not released in the United States, but becomes an absolute classic in Europe, particularly in England. Co-produced by Barry, it's called Zoom, and it is performed by Fat Larry's band. The Barry Eli team write Love Town for Booker T. Newberry III. Barry writes and co-produces Sunrise, a regional hit for Philadelphia singing sensation Brandi Wells. Barry produces an album for Las Vegas superstar Lola Falana, and in 1977, Barry produces Breaking Through, an important album for New York's famous all-girl band, Isis. There are 2 sensational singles, Loving You Through Music, which features a stunning vocal performance by lead singer Faith Fusillo, and God Give Me the Strength, with lead vocal by guitarist and vocalist, the late Carol McDonald. The album is released on United Artists, but sadly no single is ever forthcoming. On May 2, 2008, a British publisher called Bankhouse Books releases Barry's first novel, Black Like Me. It's a page-turning female superhero action novel that lives somewhere between a comic book and pulp fiction. But because Bankhouse Books is a British publisher, once again, like his records Space Base and Zoom, the book is not distributed in America. In December of 2020, Barry's second book, Pros and Cons, is released worldwide by Blue Room Books, located in the Atlanta suburb of Decatur, Georgia. Pros and Cons is edited and illustrated by Blue Room Books super editor and publisher, Angela K. Durden.
Pros and Cons is performance art in print. It's a visual representation of the harmony and discord, the consensus, compromise, and conflict of a soul always in tune and in step with truth, with a capital T. A truth that bona fide creativity always tells. Pros and Cons is part oil on the roiled waters of social justice, part fire in the belly of true civil rights struggles, and part autobiography of a man who has lived through it all. That's why Blue Room Books chose to publish this book. Only an independent publisher could appreciate, because we ourselves find the beaten path to be uninteresting and tedious. Len Barry's mind never stopped as ideas rolled out like visionary tsunamis.
Throughout the ensuing years, Barry continues to write and produce records, but none of these records finds a record label willing to release them. However, one of these records, complete with the now famous Len Barry sound and production, a record called Poetry, is being prepared for release and distribution on all social media platforms in conjunction with the publication of his latest book, the collection of lyrics, short stories, and poems, titled Pros and Cons.
All right, take a lesson from me, yeah. I got the secret. It's easy, baby. We've read it hundreds of times. We've said it so many ways. Recited it first in our nursery rhyme and all of the great Shakespeare's plays. Sometimes it comes in a song DJs on the radio play. Eventually we all sing right along, 'cause it says what we want to say. Alright, it's plain and simple. I love you and you love me. Love is calling, poetry. It's fundamental, with or without melody. Love is calling, poetry. Alright. Sometimes it comes in a kiss, in the moonlight at night shining down. It's the language of love that's on everyone's lips, 'cause love makes this world go round. Come on, same old, same old. Teachers call it history. Lovers call it poetry. Romeo said it underneath the balcony. Told Juliet it's poetry. It's easy, baby. It's plain and simple. Yeah. Cannot live without it, yeah. Don't you know it's poetry? We live in a world where love's the only reason for living. And every day when boy meets girl, another chapter of love is written, yeah. Ow! It's easy, baby. All you got to do is be cool. Easy, baby.
That's what makes it worthwhile. You know what I'm talking about. It's easy, baby.
Fundamental, elementary, sweet and gentle, warm and tender, sentimental poetry. Plain and simple, fundamental, elementary, sweet and gentle, warm and tender, sentimental poetry.
Of times, we've said it so many ways, recited it first in our nursery rhymes, and all of the great Shakespeare's plays. Sometimes it comes in a song, DJs on the radio play. Eventually we all sing right along, 'cause it says what we want to say. Alright, it's plain and simple. I love you and you love me.